We can start now that John Birch showed up. Well, first of all, I want to say thank you to everybody for coming out tonight on a beautiful Wednesday night. I know we had a little rain earlier, but this is the perfect night to get, 80-something people out on a beautiful Wednesday night. It says a lot about a lot of folks' commitment to liberty and a commitment to the ideas and values that we share. Just so you know, there's still some food and drink available over here. Bathrooms are in the corner. But before we start, I'd like to ask Army veteran Jim McConnell to lead us in the pledge.
Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. So I want to preface this by saying that every single year we do a tax day event, and we always have done this as long as AFP has been around. And I think it's a great opportunity for us to really get back to reflect on the important values of why we exist and why limited government is important. But last year we started having our first event on the Pine Tree Riot, and I will tell you that the interest in having this event again was enormous. So I guess we can say we are back by popular demand. So it's been fantastic. It's nice to get out here. What a great room. And I like the little stickers in the back of the seats. If you got a chance to see the little stickers in the back of the seats celebrating the Pine Tree Riot, they're fantastic. And it really is a great opportunity to get somewhere. And I can't tell you how many folks I've spoken to from Weare in the room who said, it's great that something's happening in here in Weare. So we're glad to come here as well. The Pine Tree Riot really was a critical event in our nation's history. As a lot of people know, obviously we started out as a British colony, and the Brits in the 18th century were the largest empire in the world, and that was driven largely by their naval power. Their naval power has really carried them forward. They would often, as many people know from if you've studied the Revolutionary War, they would rent armies. Like we learned here in the Revolutionary War, 30,000 Germans were fighting on behalf of the Brits here in the Revolutionary War. But their strength was always in their naval power. However, there's one thing you need if you're going to have a strong navy: wood. And wood is absolutely critical if you're going to be able to build ships. And one thing is, the way that the British developed a strong navy is by completely deforesting the British Isles. And particularly the old growth forest that they would use for the masts. So masts were absolutely critical to having ships that worked well. And white pines were considered to be the best wood for the purpose. And particularly old growth white pines that could be used for what they called a single stick mast. Because a single stick mast, which is just one piece of wood and not one that had been stitched together, they could withstand a full sail and a heavy gale. So those were a prized possession, a prized commodity for everyone, and in particular the British Navy. So the British Navy, as the years came forward and they had this great resource in the American colonies, and particularly this area where white pine was abundant, they decided to put forth a policy. Initially the policy was dated back into the 17th century, the 1600s, was that any white pine with a diameter of 24 inches belonged to the king. Now, for those of you who wonder what a 24-inch white pine looks like, that would be a larger one down there. And at the end of the day, that was not a huge imposition for most people, because frankly, if a tree that size gets knocked over, boy, good luck to you trying to get that out of the woods. It wasn't necessarily the most valuable thing, and even then it was still a problem. Back in 1734, my good friend Representative Dan Itzey, who was here last year, would remind us about the Mast Tree Riots of 1734. That is when the king's surveyors came out to the town of Fremont and found people cutting down trees with diameters greater than 24 inches, and the king's surveyors said that they should be taxed and penalized. Well, the folks of Fremont didn't feel the same way, And so their strategy was to tell the King Surveyor that he could either leave quickly right now and forget the whole thing ever happened, or they could kill him. He chose the former, which is probably better for his health. But that actually set forth a series of events. Governor Benning Wentworth, who was a governor of New Hampshire, appointed by the Crown, took office in 1741, not long, only 7 years after the Pine Tree Riots. And his philosophy was, look, man, we have tons of wood here. As long as the king is getting the wood he needs, we're not going to bother messing with people, particularly folks this far out. Keep in mind that the capital of New Hampshire was in Portsmouth at the time. And coming all the way out to the Piscataquag River Valley and worrying about what people were doing here, people who had given large amounts of land that frankly was completely unproductive, they had to clear it in order to use it. And they decided that was just not worth their time and effort. Because the actual policy was that the settlers couldn't cut white pines unless they had a deputy surveyor come and mark the trees with the broad arrow, the king's arrow, and saving them for the mass. And then the settlers had to pay to cut down any other white pine. So they had to pay a massive fine, which essentially amounted to a tax, because the trees and wood in 18th century America was basically the equivalent of what we would oil today. That's how precious a commodity it was. So at the end of the day, settlers, if they were subject to these taxes, would have to pay a tax in order to cut down white pines on your property. Obviously, you had to cut down white pines because they were all over the place. We were going to clear the place to use it productively for farming. That changed quite a bit, though. Governor Wentworth Benning Wentworth was moving forward. He stayed in office until 1776. 1766, and he had a policy of just leave these folks alone. Let them continue to do what they're doing, and there's no harm being done, to the population. But there was a policy in place, and it said that the surveyor's crew had the authority to mark all suitable white pines, and they also had the responsibility to go to sawmills to make sure that sawmills weren't actually cutting these white pines. As I said, it was an unenforced policy. But when he appointed his nephew, John Wentworth, was appointed as the next governor in 1766, he had this crazy idea that the government was losing out on a lot of money because they weren't charging the tax for all those white pines in the property, and they were losing out on a lot of money. And he said, boy, we really need to get on top of this. One of the first things they did is they actually reduced the dimensions from 24-inch pine to what you see over to to your right here, 12 inches. And as you can see, that is an enormous difference in the amount of wood. And I know that we have somebody who's going to talk about that later. That makes a huge difference. And suddenly he said, I'm going to start enforcing. I'm going to start going to places that we've never enforced it before. So he dispatched his deputy surveyor out to the Piscataquag Valley in the winter of 1771 and 72. And lo and behold, at the sawmills across this area, they found lots and lots of white pine that exceeded these dimensions. Lots of white pines in four mills in Goffstown and two mills here in Weare that exceeded the dimensions. So they, of course, they brought them up on charges. They charged them for illegally cutting down white pine without paying their taxes. Now the six mill owners got together and they hired a lawyer to represent them. And this lawyer, Samuel Blodgett, who was from Goffstown, was dutifully sent off to Portsmouth to represent them. Well, somewhere along the way, their attorney decided to take an offer from the governor to become a deputy surveyor. And then he proceeded to tell his clients, you know what, I think it's a really good idea if you pay your fines. Now, as you can imagine, that probably didn't go over so hot. However, the four mill owners in Goffstown decided, you know what, we're just going to pay the fine and hope that they go away. But here and where, they made of a little bit starchier backbone, and they decided we're not going to pay. We're not going to pay your fines. It's a corrupt system, which obviously made more corrupt when your lawyer gets hired to do the same job that the guy who charged you. And so they decided they weren't going to put up with this. So on April 13th, the sheriff of Hillsborough County, Benjamin Whiting, decided to come out and try to track down Ebenezer Mudgett. Ebenezer Mudgett was the largest mill owner and he was a major businessman here in the town of Weare. And he figured that if he could get Ebenezer Mudgett to pay his bills, and they could convince the rest of the people who own the mills to pay their fines as well. So he came into town looking for him, tracked him down in the evening of the 13th, of April 13th, and at that point they caught him and they arrested him. And they said, you need to pay your fines. He said he agreed, he would pay his fine the following morning. And so he would be under house arrest at his house, and the sheriff and his deputy went to, it was Quimby's Inn, which if you guys are driving down here, it's on 114, is a pink Avon store, has a mill wheel right in front of it. You'll see the mill wheel. It's the site of where Quimby's Inn was. So he was at the inn waiting, and Ebenezer Mudgett was gonna pay his fine, but he was gonna pay it in his own way. A little bit different than just giving some cash over to the government agent. So he got together with a bunch of people from across the town. Estimates are about three dozen men got together, and they went the morning of the 14th, and they broke into Quimby's Inn, and they decided that they were going to pay. They're going to pay the sheriff and his deputy back in their own way. So they showed up, and they decided to break into the sheriff's store, and they then proceeded to lift him up into the air with his face down and take switches, and they were going to repay their fine that way on the body of the sheriff or the deputy. And that was certainly an important perspective that, no doubt you can imagine, the sheriff, neither the sheriff nor the deputy really appreciated so greatly. And after they finished that, and they beat them, as some accounts say, nearly to the edge of their life, they decided to take their horses, crop off the ears, shave the manes and tails, which effectively ruins the value of the horse, and whip them out of town. And the sheriff and his deputy obviously are fairly prideful folks. They decided to come back with a posse. They reached out to Colonel Goff, who brought his posse here to Weare. Of course, at the time, the crew that had engaged in the riot had completely dispersed. They couldn't find them. Eventually, they did track them down. They tracked one down, and the others decided to come forward and face judgment. And those eight folks who came forward were held up by the court and prosecuted. But upon hearing the arguments, the judges in the case decided that they sided more with the people who were having their property unjustly taken from them than they did from the sheriff and the deputy. At the end of the day, they got a penalty of 20 shillings apiece plus court costs. That's basically like a motor vehicle fine. And the charges that were brought up against them were, this is a quote, making an assault upon the body of Benjamin Whiting, Esquire Sheriff, and that they beat, wounded, and evilly entreated him, and other injuries so did that his life was despaired of. And also, that there is charged with going against the peace of our Lord the King, his crown, and his dignity. Which probably was a fair and accurate assessment of what happened. But it sent a clear message. That message set forth a series of events that in many ways shaped the nature of our American Revolution. Because it was about 15 months after the Pine Tree Riot that the Boston Tea Party took place. A lot of people feel as though because of the very lax penalties that the Pine Tree Rioters received, that was the reason why people were willing to take the action in the Boston Tea Party. And fundamentally, it was the beginning of a series of events. And for those of you who watched the John Adams miniseries, you know what we're talking about, that led to the American Revolution. And so that's why it's so important to take a step back, understand this event's moment in our history and the importance that it places on not only where we are today, but where we stand as a society, standing up against an unjust law and unjust taxation. So I want to thank you all for coming today. We have a number of other great speakers. One of the great advantages I have at AFP and doing a Pine Tree Riot event is that our honorary chairman happens to be a tree farmer. In addition to being his great wood cookies you see below here, he can talk specifically about the importance of how this event and how these laws would impact people who are in the forestry industry. So I'd like to introduce our 2015 Conservative of the Year, and our honorary chairman, Tom Thompson.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you for all the folks coming tonight. Hopefully we can all enjoy this and walk away understanding the importance of this Pine Tree Riot many years ago. As Greg said, I am a tree farmer, a certified tree farmer, but I knew enough when you're going out to a riot to bring some security. So I brought my grandson, Jaden.
And the axe.
So. And Jaden is going to help me in a little bit here, but I wanted to first start out by thanking Americans for Prosperity and Greg and all of the staff for doing a great job over the years. I've been involved from the very beginning. I'm not sure why they keep me around, but the pay is really good. But what's interesting to me, and I think you folks, if you've been reading some of the articles this year in the legislature, that it doesn't matter whether it's the union leader or the Telegraph or New Hampshire Public Radio, even the Concord Monitor, will call Greg Moore to get a quote or his information, how he feels on a particular issue. And there have been a lot of issues like right to work, state budget, even food stamps just the other day. But Greg has a tremendous knowledge of the state and the workings of the government, and I'm proud to serve with him on the American Forest, not the American Forest, but one of the things I wanted to mention, just pick up on what Greg said. In the front, we have the samples of what, in the beginning, you could cut on your land the 24 inches, and then they passed a law, the government did, that you could only cut the 12 inches. And I'm going to ask Jaden to come up because he helps his dad scale logs sometimes, and maybe, Jaden, you can explain to them how many board feet.
So you measure how the diameter of the log is, and this one is 24 inches in diameter, and it's 16 feet long. And if we go down this, it tells you how many board feet it is, which this log was 425 board feet. And then you measure the diameter for this one, and it's 12 inches in diameter. And then it's 16 feet long, so it would be 95
board feet. And thank you, Jaden. And a board foot is a board foot is 12 inches. Oh, go ahead. Here's one.
A board foot was 12 inches by 12 inches by 1 inch thick.
That obviously is a little more than 12 inches, but I didn't want to ruin the board. It's a little over 2 board feet. But you can, from that and seeing what you have down there, and understanding that the mills were able to cut and saw 24 inch wood, and then all of a sudden, and this is on their own land, then all of a sudden the king says, no, we're changing that. Because what they felt was they were running out of these mast trees for their navy. So they said, well, we're going to bring it down to 12 inches, and before you go in and cut, you're going to have the surveyor come in, mark the trees that they want to save for the king, and then those other trees, you're going to have to pay essentially a tax, but what it was you had to buy a license to cut your own trees. you wonder why they had a riot. So back in those days, they had the old up and down sawmills, and they'd lock the log on a bed and it would run down the carriage sign one board at a time. The kerf of the saw blade, meaning the thickness of it, that took out of the log was just a quarter inch. It's called a quarter inch kerf. So every time a board was sawed, there was a quarter inch of wood that just dropped on the ground. They either burned it or they used it for their animals, whatever. But today, in the modern technology of the forest industry, they use the very, very thin blades. They're almost as thin as a razor blade, Stenner saws, and they can saw out six to eight boards at a time. And it's amazing the amount of volume they can turn out in a day. Someone's got a phone call? So, way back when the folks started coming to live here, there's this continuous argument that goes on. What is the oldest industry in the state of New Hampshire? Is it the fishing industry or is it the logging industry? And I think that it's both, because I think some of the family went fishing to get some food and the others started cutting trees to start building. But clearly the forest industry in the state of New Hampshire is the largest continuous one. Fishing is, we all know, is having a pretty rough time right now. The logging industry is also having its ups and downs with the markets, because if we don't have markets such as myself, tree farmers and landowners, we can't practice sustainable forestry. So that's important. There's probably right now 8,000 jobs in the forest industry in the state of New Hampshire. If you add other jobs that would be associated with it, it grows to around 12,000. Private forest landowners such as myself also help the state of New Hampshire by allowing snowmobiling, hunting, fishing, hiking, and all kinds of recreation on our land. And we don't get paid for anything other than when we cut trees. And just like back then, the government told them that they had to get a permit and pay a tax. In the state of New Hampshire, I hate to say this, but we have to pay a severance tax or a timber tax. Every time we harvest trees, we have to pay 10% of the stumpage value to the local community in which the trees were cut. So just to give you an idea on white pine, if white pine was selling stumpage value, if I received stumpage value was $150, or let's say $200 if it's really good, the bigger wood, not the 12-inch. 10% of that goes to the local community. They can use it for roads, for bridges. That's what the purpose of it was, but most of them just throw it into the budget and use it however. So, some things never change. I wanna finish by just telling you a little bit of a short story. It doesn't have anything to do with the Pine Tree Riot, but it was, in my family, it came pretty close to that. It was back in 2004 and 5. Some of you probably even enjoyed getting an assessment called a view tax. Well, it happened at my mother's house in Orford. She was assessed, she was 86 years old at the time. My father had passed away in 2005, and the assessment was a $100,000 view assessment, which appeared on our property card after the reevaluation. And my mother was interviewed by many, many people because she was involved, along with myself, in trying to beat that back. It was not only in New Hampshire, but it was nationwide, the publicity that we got. But then there was a reporter that called and asked if he could come up and interview her. His name was Philip Sherwell, and he was from, he was British and from the Telegraph, the Sunday Telegraph in the UK. And she ended up the article, which he quoted her on, and I think it's people can relate to this even as far back as the Pine Tree Riot. She said, "My husband, former Governor Mel Thompson, would have been furious. This, after all, is part of the world where locals like to remind British visitors that it was taxation, specifically without representation, that led to the Boston Tea Party and the American Revolution." And I think it's important for us to remember the Pine Tree Riot and focus on that, because it's still today in the legislature, there are things going on that shouldn't be going on. The government is there to serve the people, we the people, not themselves. And I would end by telling you, Greg mentioned to me when I came in today, that it was 3 years ago to the day that we had, Americans for Prosperity had the summit in Manchester, New Hampshire. And they asked if I would speak, and I did. And I spoke about Obamacare. And there were probably 800 people there. And along with a whole lot of candidates that were gearing up to run, one of them was there that is now our president. And that was on a Saturday. I went home on Monday morning. It was sent out from Manchester, New Hampshire, from the IRS, that we were being audited. This is not the only time that's happened, friends. So it took me another three months, $1,000 to $1,200 with our accountant to find out that we owed nothing. It was total harassment, and if we're gonna think about a riot, maybe we ought to do it with the IRS. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to point out that that while we think that this is a great event and a great way of bringing attention to an incredibly important historical event, there's some folks in the state who have made a little bit bigger commitment than we have to this. Our next speaker is Carl Soderberg, is a founder of Abel Ebenezer. And when you name your brewery after Ebenezer Mudgett, you've made a bigger commitment to just holding a Pine Tree Riot commemoration. So I really want to, I'm thrilled to have Carl come and say a few words. Thanks, Carl.
Well, first off, thank you guys very much for having me. I'm still a little blown away that you guys invite a beer brewer out to talk about the Pine Tree Riot, but it is, I guess I'll just tell a story. I'm a big history guy, and that kind of goes back to my days in the military. Other veterans in the room? Other Army vets in the room? I was a military officer with the Army for 4.5 years, and one of the big things that a lot of people don't know about, I mean, obviously there's a lot of field training, but one of the big things that they push on military officers and military leaders is reading military history far deeper and far beyond what they teach you in schools. Everybody's been taught about the Boston Tea Party, but barely anybody has been taught about the Pine Tree Riot or the dozens of, upon dozens of acts of civil disobedience that led up to the American Revolution. And going through those exercises of reading military history and specifically American military history, it made me hungry for more and good stories. And when me and my Army buddy came up to New Hampshire to open a brewery, we really wanted to name it after something local that we believed represented us and the things that we believed in, and also represented the independent spirit that is the Live Free or Die State. And the story of Ebenezer Mudgett and the Pine Tree Riot just made perfect sense. It really is a hell of a story, and I'm actually I love the fact that we have this event because I think it starts to bring attention to it. There's a lot of people who were born and raised in New Hampshire actually don't know a lot about the Pine Tree Riot or how critical it was leading up to the American Revolution. I mean, you talk about one of the biggest contributors to the economy up here being taken away by the British by force. Obviously, you can draw parallels to today, but you can understand why people put everything they had on the line the day that the sheriff and his deputy came riding up here, right up 114. This road actually existed back during the late 1700s. This was a masked road. For those who don't, masked roads, like if you drive through downtown Goffstown, it's terrible the way that it's designed. But that's how they got the logs, the long logs down the road all the way down to the Merrimack River, which is how they got them to the ports. So I love the amount of rich history that's up here. And I love the fact that actually right now we're standing a mere couple miles away from what could be argued is the beginning of the American Revolution. So what makes it a big part of the American Revolution? It was one of the key events. I mean, the colonies at the time had gone through over a century of civil disobedience, a lot of it ranging from rebellions and turnover in power happening in England. There were religious riots. This was the first that had to do with property that actually, and this actually made national news. This is one of the reasons why a lot of people point to the Pine Tree Riot, and you see, you know, everyone familiar with the flag of New England? It's actually the main battle flag at Bunker Hill. Following the Pine Tree Riot, militiamen from New England chose the pine tree as their first symbol, as an homage to the Pine Tree Riot. It was the first symbol, it was the first item that they had stood up and fought for, and they'd stripped away all the fear of repercussion from the local from the British government. Yeah. A lot of people don't know, a lot of people have seen the flag, but they don't know what it means. Some people like to say that the tree on it is the Liberty Tree from Boston, which isn't true. But yeah, the pine tree was a very important symbol to the people of New England, and they carried pine tree flags throughout the American Revolution. George Washington's actually first, when he arrived at the Siege of Boston after the battles of Lexington and Concord, he had six merchant ships converted over into military cruisers. They were our first military, basically just mounted cannons to the deck. And the flag that they chose, the flag that George Washington chose, is the Appeal to Heaven flags. People familiar with the Appeal to Heaven flag? Mm-hmm. It's a white banner, big pine tree. It says Appeal to Heaven on the bottom, which is from John Locke's Second Treatise of Government, where he talks about, as a person, if you're wronged, what things can you appeal to? You appeal to the courts, you appeal to the ballot box, you appeal to your fellow citizens. After being turned down enough times, the last thing you can do is appeal to heaven, and that's when you basically throw all your chips in and riot against the deputy, because the belief back then was if your cause is just, then heaven, God, whatever that unintangible thing that we really just can't describe will actually see us through. And if you look at the American Revolution, that's exactly what happened. It was an impossible war against a world power by a small insurgent force that was roaming the hills of New England. Pine Tree Riot. I actually really would love to see the day when this room is just full of people. This becomes a huge event. I'd love to be able to serve beer outside. I think it kind of segues into the whole purpose of this. So you talk about the taxes on cutting trees. We have the same thing in the beer industry. Every gallon of beer that we produce gets taxed twice. When you're drinking a pint of beer in the state of New Hampshire, it's been taxed three times by the time you drink it. By the federal government, the state government, and then you have meals and rooms tax, and obviously that varies from state to state, but just producing it. So just like cutting logs, you get taxed on cutting the log every gallon that crosses our taxable beer line in the facility, meaning it goes into a cold room, we have to log and report every month and cut a check. And I think that's really what it comes down to. I know there's a lot of politicians in the room. I'm not a politician. Stuff drives me crazy. I'm just, it's, and you know, more power to you. I respect anybody who's willing to, you know, go through the headache of what it is to be a politician. And any time I have to go to the State House to try and defend beer taxes, like, I mean, defend increases in them, which there was a bill earlier this year, thankfully didn't make it past committee. But, you know, that's time consuming for a business owner. I work for a living, like a lot of people in this room. I don't have time to read statutes and laws, and there's just so much of it. It's a full-time job in itself. And I think that's really what it comes down to, is when the burden of your government starts to become so much on the people that actually work, that get things done, that move society forward, that's when I think things start to hit a breaking point. Whether or not we're near something like that now, I don't know. But we wanted to create a company that wasn't just a brewery. For us, it was about way more than beer, because beer is something that's not an experience in itself. It's a catalyst to another experience, whether you're having a good time with your friends, watching the game. For us, it was telling stories. When we were in the Army, when we weren't training or deployed overseas, we liked to sit around a craft beer bar, drink beer, and tell stories, whether it was a weird story from last night or a really cool story from 240 something years ago. We wanted to create an environment where everything we had a story that represented us, and we really believe that for us, being a small brewery in New Hampshire, being able to tell this story about Ebenezer and the Pine Tree Ride, to be able to create an experience where this was the focal point, we were doing more than just making beer. We were actually starting a conversation. And we opened in June 2014. 2015, or 2016 is the first Pine Tree Ride event. This is the second, correct? Yeah, and we're gonna have many more to come. But I would really love to keep spreading the story, keep telling the story. That's what I encourage all of you to do. Because it's really only going to grow, not just, because it's more than just a story, it's an ideology. It represents who we are and the things that we believe in. And at the end of the day, that's something I think that we could stand up here and have all political arguments in the world, and you know how you politicians do. Talking in circles, lawyer talking, all that stuff. But at the end of the day, a good story is something I believe that we can all relate to, and the principles of individualism, of individual liberty, of freedom, the very basis of why this country exists in the first place is really all embedded in this one story. And it means the world to me. As proof of concept, you know, taking this weird story that no one had ever heard of before and branding an entire brewery off of it, we were just named Veteran-Owned Business of the Year by the SBA. We just won Best Brewery. We were voted Best Brewery in New Hampshire third year in a row. But these are all venues now where the story is getting in. The story is being told again and again and again, and it's getting in front of more people. And yes, we make an incredible product. We stand behind it 100%. But I think, you know, something about a product that's intangible and subjective is, how do you relate to it? The relationship that you build with it. And for us, we're not trying to attract beer connoisseur, beer drinkers. I want the people who work for a living in New Hampshire. I want the people who get up every day and move the world forward. And I think that those people really resonate with the story of the Pine Tree Riot. So with that, I guess if anybody has any questions, I'll take them. But otherwise, we'll see you guys. Yes, sir.
What does ABLE stand for?
He's a man of ability. You know, somebody can get things done, capable. Something that's always meant a lot to me is you can put everything you want onto a resume of all the things that you've done in the classes you've taken or the degrees that you have, but at the end of the day, it comes down to, can you get things done? And Ebenezer was a man, if you really dive deep into the history, he was a pillar, a leader here in the local community. He was one of the first settlers to move out to Weare, and this was frontier country back in the 1760s. So taking a risk right there, leaving his home, when he cleared his lot, he built his first house out of the pine logs that were on his property. He then built the first town hall, or the first building that ended up being used as a town hall. He opened a tavern. He ran his mill business. He was a what I guess what you would call today a serial entrepreneur, and he was building the world the way that he saw it out here in middle of nowhere, New Hampshire, and people followed him. And then this nobody, the night that everybody gathers at the tavern and, yes, drinking pints of ale and talking about what they were gonna do about these fines or were they gonna be arrested, they took a stand and said, you know what? The person who's saying that the trees that are out here belong to them, they didn't come out here and forage across, you know, however many miles it is from Portsmouth to out here. They didn't cut down all the trees. They didn't haul them all the way down to the, you know, all the work that goes into, not a logger, but it's a lot of work, a lot of labor, and a lot of risks were taken, and the people who took none of those risks wanted to benefit from it. So I think that's where the name Abel comes from. It sounded way better than Ebenezer Budget Brewing Company. But yeah, we actually, four of the, we have four replica pine tree flags that hang up in our brewery. If anyone's, has anyone been to the brewery? We have a bar that's open. See a few realtors. Yeah, we hang up the pine tree flags, and these are the stories that we tell at the bar. A lot of people come in and ask, well, what is this flag? It's a really cool story to be able to tell over a beer, and inevitably they'll order a second. We have John Trumbull's The Death of General Warren at Bunker Hill. It's a really large, we have really large painting we have hanging on the wall. If anyone's not familiar with the painting itself, it's John Trumbull was actually one of the witnesses of the Battle of Bunker Hill. And right above General Warren's body, this flag is flying. Because again, he witnessed the battle. But that's the historical reference that this flag, the flag of New England, one of the first pine tree flags, inspired by the Pine Tree Riot, was the main battle flag that day at Bunker Hill. Key part of American history, and I think the rest of the country should be talking about it more. Yes, ma'am.
Why did you pick New Hampshire to open your brewery?
I've always wanted to, I mean, the brewery was kind of secondary. I just wanted to live in the live for your die state. Right. New Hampshire. I grew up in the Washington, D.C. area. which is a soul-crushing place to live. But for me, when I left home at 18 and went to college and just in the Army traveling all around, the one thing I knew I didn't want to do was go back there. And I loved everything about New Hampshire. I love the people here. I mean, that's really what it comes down to, the independent spirit. I mean, you drive an hour south across the border into Massachusetts, like a whole new world. And that, I think that's how unique New Hampshire is. And I travel around the country and I tell my family about it. And a lot of people don't really believe it until they come up and see it. New Hampshire really is a special place. That's I knew that this is where I wanted to be. Once I was here, it was, how do I build a brewery? So yeah, live for your die state. By the way, New Hampshire is the number one state for veterans to relocate to per capita after exiting the military. Yeah. For those who don't know. In a lot of liberty circles, you know, the military can get a bad rap, but you know, the people that raise their right hand and volunteer to defend something as subjective as freedom, but it's not subjective, but I don't know, I think it really goes to the core of you know, what does it mean to raise your right hand and volunteer to stand up for words written on our Constitution and you know, really willing to fight for an idea. And it's something that we believe in, it's something that brings us all together, and it's another reason why I love New Hampshire. A lot of like-minded people, they believe in something. Anything else? Well, thank you guys very much.
Thanks. And he, you know, he might say he's not a politician, but you know, some of you guys can start working on him now. But obviously, this is a huge impact for the town of Weare. If you go onto Weare's Wikipedia page and you ask about history and the collapsing tables in the back, please stay away from them. But if you look at Weare and the history of Weare, this is the most significant event in the history of this town. And I think that it's important to hear from some of the people who live here. Talk about the relevance of the Pine Tree Riot and what it means to the folks here in Weare. So, Howard Kalugian, first of all, thank you for you and Martha for getting the room for us, but Love to hear from your perspective as well.
Thank you, Greg. Martha and I live here in Weare, and we have for about 2 years now. And we were very much inspired by the Pine Tree Riot story when we heard about it. So we thought, we've got to commemorate that. We have to remember this each and every year. And the idea that it went all the way to trial means that we could actually recreate that here. One day, perhaps, we can have a mock trial, having witnesses come and testify as to what they saw and what occurred. We can have somebody from the government come and try to persuade the jury that it's a just law and they should be fined heavily. And then we could have you, the audience, be the jury and decide whether the tyranny of taking people's property or the freedom of defending your land is something that you would vote for. And so I hope that one day this can grow into a big civic event, and yes, we will serve your beer. But we'd like to welcome the Americans for Prosperity organization here. We love AFP. We think that anybody who hears the name should be for it. But you know, how does prosperity occur? What we've learned in America is that with the right laws, prosperity occurs. And with the wrong policies, you can have poverty with the exact same people. You know, I like looking at the map of the world at night. And if you focus in on the Korean Peninsula, it's really quite amazing to see these are the same people ethnically, they're the same people in heritage, they're the same people culturally, they're the same people religiously. They have everything identical. They even share the same peninsula and natural resources. And yet, when you look at it at night, South Korea is ablaze with light. It's on fire. There's light everywhere because they have prosperity and they're able to feed themselves. In North Korea, it's dark except for the small little palace where one man lives. It takes an entire country to feed one man in North Korea. And so they have the wrong policies in North Korea. Here, what are the policies that the Pine Tree Riot demonstrates are right? Private property rights. Property rights is one of the foundation elements of having prosperity and being allowed to feed your family and to bless the rest of the community. And frankly, when you take away the resources from the land that people have, as these cookies, I think we call them, the wood cookies of the trees demonstrate, then frankly, you're going to destroy that prosperity that people were hoping for. And that is, in fact, what led to the Boston Tea Party and the Declaration of Independence eventually. And you know, it's not that they were riotous in the sense that they were lawless. They wanted just laws. It's not just to take away your property. It's the wrong thing to do. And when you look at the Declaration of Independence, it actually sets forward the ideas behind why we had to separate from the crown. And there are a lot of legislators here, future legislators, past legislators. In fact, I've learned being in New Hampshire, everybody's in the legislature at one time. Either they have been, they are, or they one day will be. So everybody should know this. The very first cause of separation that Thomas Jefferson and the Continental Congress wrote about was as follows. They said that the king has refused his assent to laws, the most wholesome and necessary for the public good. You see, they weren't objecting to the fact that we didn't have bad laws. They weren't objecting to bad laws, they were objecting to, we don't have the laws that are for our good. It's not that they were anarchists. It's not that they wanted lawlessness, like a riot would imply. It was that they wanted laws that were for our good. And they didn't have that. It goes on. The king has forbidden his governors to pass laws of immediate and pressing importance. We have needs. We have an immediate and pressing need in our community, and you're not allowing us to address it. The third point. He has refused to pass other laws for the accommodation of large districts of people unless the people would relinquish the right of representation in the legislature, a right inestimable to them and formidable to tyrants only. So you see, the idea of passing the right laws is why we separated from England. They didn't give us just laws. We wanted just laws. And I hope that those who are currently in the legislature will take that to heart and give us just laws, beginning with property rights. And ladies and gentlemen, there is no greater property than the right of what you have earned, the fruit of your labor. It's even scriptural to say that the laborer is worthy of his wages. And so we live in a state without an income tax. I hope that you'll all remain active to keep it that way. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Greg. I want to thank you all for coming out and visiting us here in Weare. I met somebody in Massachusetts. I'm glad he came up here to see what freedom is like, but I really don't know why you're in Massachusetts. I hope you'll come join us here in the Live Free or Die State, Greg?
So first of all, I think that now's the time where I get a little nervous. We actually have our 2014 Conservative of the Year coming up to say a few words. The last time I put him in front of a microphone at an AFP event, he made some national headlines. Got into a little tete-a-tete with the President of the United States, which the President deserved, to be frank, and is right. And he's my old boss. This is someone who cares deeply about personal property rights, cares deeply about taxation. He cared so much about taxation that when our government had spending go out of control and we had a $900 million hole in our budget, he said, not one dime in new taxes. We passed the budget, and some folks here were part of that process. We passed the budget, they cut spending, our budget by 11%. Cut the state funded portion of the budget by 17%. Not only that, it actually, over the course of 2 years that he was in charge, not only did they not raise any taxes and fees, cut 20 taxes and fees throughout the process, and at the same time, still made sure that the bridges weren't collapsing like in Atlanta, and our schools weren't shoving kids out into the snow. Managed to get the job done because he understood that being responsible is being responsible with the money of the people who earned it. And we're going to share that success with the people who earn it every day through their hard work and their sacrifices. So with that, I want to hand it over to Bill O'Brien, former speaker.
Greg, you made pretty good, you know? You did all right after you left my
plane. Get a good team.
He did. I appreciate you having me here today, and I want to thank Tommy Thompson for your continued advocacy. You're an example for all of us, and we're so glad that you're staying with us and reminding us of what you've advocated over the years and who your father was, too. He's an inspiration, and I have to tell you, as speaker, I didn't go through any day that I didn't think of your father. And the banner that he had across his office was, which I think I have it right, which is low spending as a low taxes as a result of low spending. And Carl, thank you, and all the veterans here, thank you for your service. Carl, you also for your beer, appreciate that. You know, we have and Howard, you know, and Martha for arranging this venue, we really appreciate it. It's just great to sit there looking at the back of the chairs and see the reference to the Pine Tree Riot. There's one group I want to ask to stand because the group of state representatives that we have up at Concord and the state representatives in this room really aren't politicians. We're not polished enough to be politicians. So why don't you guys stand and get the recognition. Terrorist, you can sit down now. If you are, you know, one of the things that Greg did ask me, he said, you know, you spent the last week, I'm told, terrorizing the legislature. So you're not terrorizing the meeting, so I'm going to try to keep it a little bit under control here. Yeah, because I understand that one of the most devastating insults that in our political world can be visited upon anyone is to be called a terrorist. Terrorists destroy for the purpose of destruction only. They're heartless, they're cruel, they're motivated by unreason and unreasonable prejudice. Terrorists are evil and we hate what they do. It's one of the worst insults that can be visited upon any politician. So let me tell you a secret about government and those who run government. They think if you're against high taxes, you're a terrorist. They think if you don't want unfair taxes, then you're a terrorist. They think if you object to ever-increasing taxes, you're a terrorist. For Governor Wentworth and for the royal government in New Hampshire in 1772, mill and landowners in Weare were terrorists when they stopped the crown from stealing the best lumber. For King George and the royal government in Massachusetts the next year, the Sons of Liberty, who threw the tea into the harbor because it was brought in by a royal monopoly and with high taxes, were terrorists. It's always been the same. To the government elites in 1772 and 1773, and to the government elites today, low tax advocates are the barbarians at the gates. We're terrorists. So for years now in New Hampshire, we've heard the liberal progressives say that low tax advocates are evil because we think that the money we earn, first off, starts being our money. And we may not want it taken and used for growing government, which after all reduces our liberty. But we're not terrorists. Instead, just as the Weare mill owners knew in 1772 and the Sons of Liberty knew in 1773, we've been taxed enough. And even this past week, we have heard the echoes of King George III when King Sean I up in Concord and his legacy media elites at the Union Leader and the failing Concord Monitor said we're terrorists when we stopped an increase of over 10% in state-funded spending. 10% in one budget they wanted to increase spending. Not during bad times, during good times, an increase that would have brought on the same condition that we had to handle 6 years ago of not enough revenue and too much spending. You know, the insults will not cause us to abandon the goal of not paying too much in taxes, the goal of the Tea Party. And from one generation to the next, there will always be a Tea Party. There will always be low tax advocates who will say, just as the mill owners did in 1772, just as the Sons of Liberty said in 1773, just as was said in the Declaration of Independence, there are limits on how much we can be taxed and how much liberty you can steal. And when you go too far, we stand ready to once again ride you out of town on a rail. Thank you.
So you know you're having a good event when people from the area to say, hey, listen, can I get up and say a couple words as well? And from our perspective, we are a grassroots, bottom-up organization. So Russ Nelson, come on up. You want to say a few words? Come and say a few words.
Sure.
I'm going to go this way. Okay, well, hop up. Long legs,
sure. I'm woefully unprepared because all of my reference books are still in the boxes that they came in when we moved here 2 weeks ago. So glad to be here in the live for your die state and escape the confines, constrictors of New York State. Woo! Totally. So I want to share with you something that I was not taught by the government schools, something that I had to research on my own, which is that the American Revolution was not defined by the battles that were fought. The Battle of Bunker Hill, or the Boston Massacre, or any of the other conflicts that went on during the war. It's not like freedom increased as a step function with every battle that was fought. No, liberty increased by having alternative institutions. Before 1776, before the Pine Tree Riot, there were alternative institutions. If you wanted to sue somebody, you could sue them in the English courts, or you could sue them in the American courts. If you wanted to pay a fine, you could pay it in pounds, or you could pay it in scrip. So for every British institution, there was an American institution. The battles backed them up. The people who did the Pine Tree Riot, they didn't, you know, with all due respect, they weren't inspired by alcohol. They were inspired by an idea. It's not like it was a bunch of drunks that got together and said, hey, let's go have a party and let's have a turn it into a riot. No. They were backed up by the strength of the institutions. So, given that there were courts, there were American courts and there were British courts, what do we have now? Well, we have, you know, the legal system, but we also have arbitration. If you buy a piece of software, actually read the fine print. Go ahead and read it. You're going to get down to the point at the bottom where it's going to say, I don't remember the exact legal terms, but all conflicts under this license will be decided by arbitration. Arbiters, and the American, specifically the American Arbitration Society or Association. Those are our alternative courts. And they're in use all over the place. There are more private security people than there are publicly funded policemen. There's our private enforcers, our private policemen, and we've got private courts. We don't need a revolution. Who here wants to fight a war? Nobody here wants to fight a war. So how do we get from here to more freedom? We start using these alternative institutions more than we do the public institutions. Back probably around the same time as the Pine Tree Riots, within the association or the Society of Friends, the Quakers, you did not go to the courts first. First, you went to the person, then you went to the meeting, and you kept it within the society. Well, we can do similar things like that. Keep it within us. If you have to sue somebody, do it privately. Don't rely on the government. Thank you.
And our last speaker, again, someone who said, hey, can I come up and say a few words? Here is the, I guess, the terrorist leader these days. I just want to say that 2 weeks ago, the New Hampshire House Freedom Caucus didn't exist. 1 week ago, the state budget died in the New Hampshire House, and everyone is accusing you of doing it. So I want to have JR say a few words.
Thank you, Mike.
I guess 3 weeks ago, it wasn't on my roadmap anywhere to be in this position. I just didn't like a budget that was dishonest and grew spending by 10%. And I think all of you can get involved the same way. At the end of the day, it takes a person highly motivated who says, you know what, this is no longer good enough. Okay? It's not fair to my children to raise government growth so fast that they won't have the same things that I inherited from my parents in terms of a place to raise a family, to start a business. We were accused of having no ideas. There's a calendar as thick as this one, okay, that was filled with amendments by people who are working on solutions. Speaker didn't want to acknowledge those. At the end of the day, we came to the table multiple times to try and give a solution to put a budget forward that was a reasonable budget that constrained spending to the growth of inflation and no more. And constantly, our leadership shut us down. But we can pick this ball up now. We started this fight, but we can pick this ball up, each of you, by getting involved with your friends. Letters to the editor that say, you know what, I'm not happy when government is growing faster than inflation. That puts me at risk. I'm on a fixed income. When that happens, not me personally, but when people are on fixed incomes and government is growing at a rate faster than inflation, that means at the end of the day, they lose money. That puts them at risk of loss of homes. We saw that in Londonderry.
So let's pick this ball up that we started last week on a fight on the House floor and continue this and make sure the budget that's passed this year is not the budget that the House had, because that had $219 million of real revenue that they were hiding behind the scenes. It was actually a $12.1 billion budget. Let's make it a budget that constrains to the GOP platform and doesn't waste resources. There's lots of places we can find within the current budget and departments to cut spending and to economize the program so that they actually work. Thank you.
Thank you, Jared. I just want to wrap up by saying that the fact that you're here today shows that you're committed to the ideas and the values of the folks who on April 14, 1722 said, we are not going to stand by and idly allow our government to roll over us. We're not going to allow our rights to be taken. We're not going to be hit with an unjust tax. I would say to you that it's absolutely critical that you take that passion and turn it into activism. It is absolutely critical for the process. It is absolutely critical for all of us continue to fight the fights that we just heard about just now. Not just the fights dating back to 1722, but the ones that just date back to last week. It is absolutely critical that everyone stay involved. The Americans for Prosperity, we do that all the time. Right now, we're advocating for a smaller budget. We think that in a booming economy, the benefits of that economy should be shared back with the hardworking taxpayers who earn that money. That means the people out there who are working every day, being entrepreneurial, taking risk, and taking the willingness to fail, and put their heart and treasure behind it. That is exactly the spirit that we saw from folks like Ebenezer Mudgett, and it's absolutely the spirit that we need to fight to continue to be the live free or die state. That is absolutely something that we cannot lose. I'd be thrilled if you joined us. There are certainly other organizations that could use your help. We are committed to fighting this fight every single day. Not just at the state level, but also at the national level. When they're having a conversation about tax reform, we want to make sure to continuously remind them that there are hardworking taxpayers who are sacrificing every day. And we should think about them and make sure that they're able to benefit as well. And at a time when we still have a situation where Americans are taxed for choosing not to buy a product, there's a fundamental problem. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's bad enough they're taxing you when you're making beer. But the federal government will tax you for not buying something. So when we have an environment where you're taxed for not buying a good or a service, or being taxed too much for the hard work and the fruits of your labor, it's absolutely time to take action. So, like I said, we'd love to have you, any and all of you, join us and continue this fight. Certainly there are a lot of great people here and other organizations as well. I just want to give a shout out before we go to a couple people who really work their tail off every single day. One is our grassroots director, Ross Conley, in the back. Fantastic field director out in Dover, Sarah Scott. Tom Thompson has been a phenomenal asset to us from the very beginning of this chapter. And all the hardworking volunteers I see here every day who are asking themselves, how do I move the ball a little further forward today? How do we just move this forward a little more today? And the incremental steps that we make every day make a huge difference. A huge difference. And sometimes that activism is, as I know John and Laura Spottiswood, coming in and making phone calls for us, or out making phone calls for us, and sometimes it's people like JR, people who go up to Concord every day to do battle against special interests who want nothing more than to increase your taxes so they can spend more of your money. So every single day I would encourage you to get involved and stay involved. That's the spirit that led to the Pine Tree Riot back in 1722, and that's the spirit that we need to live up to every single day. So thank you so much. There's still some food if you want, and I'm sure that everybody who spoke would be happy to answer a few questions later. Thanks.